Good morning. Good to see everyone out this morning. It's good to see. I see Miss Virginia back there, so it's good to see her this morning. Thank you for being here in the house of the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, see what He has for us this morning. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day. Thank You for the opportunity to be in Your house, to worship and to praise You. Lord, we ask for Your presence to be in our presence this morning. Lord, we pray that You are glorified and magnified in all that's said and done. Lord, I pray that if there's one here that doesn't know You, that today would be the day of salvation. Speak to our hearts as only You can, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's turn to page 410. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. We'll sing the first, the third, and the last. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. 454, I'd rather have Jesus. We'll sing all three of this. I'd rather have Jesus. 454.
Thank you.
to the services this morning. As you're returning to your seat, we'll turn to page 575. 575, stand up for Jesus. Thank you. You may be seated. This time, I'm going to have Miss Evelyn come.
Okay, I'm going to play three different songs. The first one is My Jesus, I Love Thee. If you want to follow in the hymnal, it's 160. And then His Name is Wonderful, that's 24. And then I Love You, Lord, which is number 9. Sing that last one together. I love you, Lord. All right, let's sing it.
Amen.
Miss Evelyn. Appreciate that. Appreciate you being here this morning. I've already been blessed for being in the house of the Lord. Amen. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And I woke up this morning, had a headache, but I was still excited about getting to the Lord's house. And I'm hoping and praying that you have that same excitement. I tell you, if we, let me just throw this in there. This is free. It's not in the notes or anything. But if we as parents don't get excited about coming to church, our children aren't going to be excited about it. So we need to be excited about coming to church. It's not something we have to do, but it's something we get to do. I remember whenever I was a kid, and I know that was a long time ago, but I remembered as a kid, my parents, we would go to Kings Island once a year. And we didn't have to go, but we got to go. And I looked forward to every time that time came that we got to go and stand in line for 2 hours, because it was always on the weekends. We had to go on Saturday because Dad couldn't take off work. And we'd stand in line for 2 hours to go ride a ride. And how I got so excited about that. Why can't we get excited about being in God's house and worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Well, that was just a side note, but I thought it was good anyway. I'm going to ask you to join me in Deuteronomy chapter number 13. Deuteronomy chapter number 13. A couple weeks ago, I preached on the choice is yours. The choice is yours. Well, today, I guess it's part two. Lord just started dealing with my heart again about this. And so it's going to be part two of the choice is yours. And I don't know what Brother Adam titled it on the message on the internet or whatever, but that's what I've titled it. And so this morning, that's what we're going to look at. I said that we need to choose whether we want to please God or please self. Someone has said there's two choices on the shelf, pleasing God or pleasing self. The choice between a curse or a blessing, that's what we were talking about there. And it's an easy choice, easy decision for us to make. We want to be blessed. Well, the fact of the matter is that we all need to be obedient to the Lord. If you're a Christian, God has called you to be obedient to the Lord and the Holy Spirit's leading. We need to be obedient to the Word of God's heeding and the Lord Jesus' leading in our lives. When God says something, it's our responsibility, it's our duty, it's our obligation to be obedient in the Lord. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. Let's turn to Deuteronomy 13. We're going to read the first four verses here, and I think you'll see where I'm going with this. But the Bible says, if there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams and giveth thee a sign or a wonder, and the sign or the wonder come to pass whereof he spake unto thee, say, let us go after other gods, which thou hast not known, and let us serve them. Thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God proveth you to know whether ye love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Ye shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and ye shall serve him and cleave unto him. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for all that you do. Lord, we ask that you would just speak to our hearts during this message this morning. Show us, Lord, where the blessings are from being obedient to you. Lord, again, if there's one here that doesn't know you, may today be the day of salvation. Lord, may they not boast thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. Lord, do a work that only you can get the glory and only you can get the credit for. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. See, the choice is up to you, obedience or disobedience. When we look at the book of Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament, in fact, it'll be 400 years before the children of Israel, the nation of Israel, hear the voice of God once again. And that will be when John the Baptist, when he cries out in Matthew 3:2, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What we find at the Old Testament, that the Jewish people thought they had an advantage. They thought they knew what was best for them in their lives. For the past several weeks, I don't know about you, but I follow a lot of news. I just want to see what's going on in our nation, want to see what's going on And for the past several weeks, I've been hearing this debate over abortion. I didn't mean to be political this morning, but this is the way the Lord's leading. And so this debate over abortion, and can I say, church, there's no debate. God said it in His Word that He knew us before He formed us in the womb. And the Bible says, lo, children are a heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is His reward. So children are a blessing unto the Lord, whether it's out of wedlock, whether it's out of rape. I don't care. You name the circumstance, you name the situation, it doesn't matter. They are still a blessing unto the Lord. You see, we're created for His pleasure and for His glory. See, I think like the children of Israel, we must have forgotten that the Lord knows all and sees all. There's this a debate going on in our country right now whether it's okay to abort a baby at whenever they're already been born. I mean, it's this last term or whatever, this abort. I'm telling you, it's wrong, it's wicked. And nothing sickens me more than this. You know, and I believe it's taken effect on our nation. And I think the songs that Brother Adam picked this morning was perfect. He had no idea where I was going. But Christians, we need to stand up for Jesus. See, I think like the children of Israel, we've forgotten that He's in control. We're to please Him. It doesn't matter. As we read here, it says, if there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, if there arise up a congress, a group of people that think they know better than God, listen to what the Bible says. It says, you shall walk after the Lord your God and fear Him. And keep His commandments and obey His voice, and ye shall serve Him and cleave unto Him. Not to what the world says is what we need to do, not what society or a group of people say we need to do, but what does God say we need to do? That's what we need to hold on to. You see, I've said this before, but the ruin of any nation happens, it starts off this way. Number one, it starts off by a spiritual turning away. A spiritual turning away. This is where every nation that has been judged by God began, by a spiritual turning away. This is where America began many years ago, taking God out of the schoolhouse, taking God out of the home, taking Bible out of the schoolhouse, taking Bible out of the home, taking it out of the government. This is where America started out years ago. You see, His Word used to be the focal point in our homes. His Word was even a focal point in many schools, in public schools. And you know, do you realize this, that a lot of colleges started as Christian organizations? They start out with curriculums for Christians. Many universities were started that way, on biblical principles. This nation was founded on biblical principles. We have turned from the true and living God and now embracing the false gods of this world, humanism and secularism. See, there's only one true God. That is the Lord God, Jehovah. See, that the Bible says, thou shalt not have any other gods before me. I have a burden for America because we have turned from the living, the true God. You see, it's sad today that America is in a religious apostasy. Spiritual turning away from God. I mean, this is where it starts with every nation. And folks, we started years ago. Then the second step is a moral turning away. Now, do we not see this in America today? There's no question that America is in the midst of a moral decay. I mean, we are throwing every sense of decency out of our society. We see it in the number of abortions that are performed every year. I read some time ago that every 26 seconds a baby is being aborted. That's what we know about. That's 137 per hour and over 3,300 per day. Do you think that is putrid in the nostrils of God? The Bible says without natural affection. That's what that means. mothers not having a love for their babies. Without natural, that is wrong. You see, we see it in how sodomy is normalized, and it's not normal. God says this in Romans 1:27, it says, "And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of a woman," now I don't have to explain that to you, "burning their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly," God says it's unseemly, "and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet." You see, this transgender movement, this is another thing that's going on in our society. I don't know if you guys are putting your heads in the sand or what, but we need to wake up. I'm not trying to be mean or ugly this morning, but this is some things that need to be said. See, we see it in the passing of these ungodly laws, these transgenders. I saw Brother Luke was telling me yesterday how there was two transgender boys that were running a girls' race and said they were girls, and so they won the state finals, first and second place, these two transgenders. Folks, they have no right to be running with the girls. I thought I was going to get a lot of amens this morning, but I guess I'm not. See, women don't belong in the same room, the restrooms, as men, and men don't belong in the same rooms as women. Bible says, Deuteronomy 22:5, you say you got Bible? Yeah. "The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all that do so are an abomination unto the Lord thy God." I believe that the Bible is just as relevant today as it was 2,000 years ago. We hear in the heathenistic music that has infested our homes and in churches today, I mean, the list could go on and on about the moral decay that is happening in our society in America today. We need to wake up. Then the third step is political turning away. Let me say again, this nation was founded on biblical truths as its core foundation. Many of the founding fathers were Christians. And any reasonable person can see that we are a heartbeat away from total political collapse. See, now where's the problem? Is it in the White House? Is it in the congregation or in the Congress? Is it where's the problem? Nothing is going to help our country until we that are start getting people saved and start turning away from the things that are wicked and start turning back to the Lord. Until we turn back to the true and living God, hey, there's no hope for America. See, we will continue to plunge towards destruction in the name of tolerance and separation of church and state. Where we say, hey, there should be separation, church and state. You know that what that was? That was to protect the church from the state. That's what that was formed there for. See, that is basically the introduction this morning, and it just gets better from there. America needs to get back to obeying God. See, I'd like to see what God has to say about a few things this morning. The Bible says in Romans 3:4, it says, "God forbid, yea, let God be true and every man a liar." What's he say there again in Deuteronomy? Let's read it again. It says, "If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams and giveth thee a sign or a wonder, and the sign or the wonder come to pass whereof he spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods." You say, well, that's not what our nation's... Yes, that's what our nation's doing. "Which thou hast not known, and let us serve them. Thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet or the dreamer of dreams or the Congress or the representatives or the White House." It doesn't matter. You fill in the blank there. "Whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, ye shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him." Now notice this. "And fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and you shall serve him and cleave unto him." God's commanded us here. Now, here's where it meets the road. You're going to obey him, or you're going to obey the law? Because it may come down to that decision right there. And I'm going to see just some few things. What does God have to say about sin? Number one, God says that sin is terrible. It's horrific. It's disgusting to God. You know, sin hinders our prayer life. I mean, you examine your own life right now. And you know that when there's sin in your life, you may say some words in front of your family, words of prayer, but it's not getting any higher than this ceiling. You know that. Why? Because there's iniquity in your heart. The Bible says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. You see, sin divides, it derives a wedge in our fellowship with God. Now, let me say here, I say this all the time, if you're saved, if you're a Christian this morning, nothing can change the fact that you are saved and on your way to heaven. Amen. However, your fellowship, the sweet fellowship that you once enjoyed with the Lord has been severed, or has been a big wedge in between there. Why? Because of your sins in your life. The Bible says this, if we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, walk in sin, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he's in the light, if we walk in the truth, the light, the truth, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Ultimately, sin causes death. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. I hear people say, well, I think this. I tell you this. You look on Facebook and there's a lot of people that will say, they'll give all their political advice. They'll give all their opinions. They'll give, I think this. I think this. I feel this. Let me say something. I don't care what you think. I don't care how you feel. What does God say? What does God say? It doesn't matter what I say. Folks, it does not matter. Who cares what Pastor Brown says? What does God say about the matter? And God says that sin is terrible, it's disgusting, it's horrific. See, there are 413 passages in the Old Testament that we find the phrase, thus saith the Lord. And when the Lord repeats something, we better listen to what he has to say. And many of these deal with sin or a result of sin in our lives. Don't try to justify your sin by calling it a little white lie or trying to rename it. I was telling our teenagers this morning, did you know this? Now, maybe some of you don't know this, but I have firsthand experience of this. Well, secondhand, I guess. But did you know that if you are an alcoholic, you can get disability? Anybody know that? Why? Because if you're an alcoholic, that's a sickness. That's a disease. Who can blame someone for being sick, right? No, that's a choice. It's a sin choice. You see, it's not alcohol. It's not an alcoholic. It's a drunkard. That's what the Bible calls it. Why? Because that's sin. Drunkenness is sin. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. And I can go on and on. Drunkenness, did you know this? That drunkenness is one of the leading killers or responsible for the deaths, most deaths in America? Let me say, only by the grace of God he saved me from being a drunkard. See, we have changed the name of sin, the name sin of sodomy, to being gay. Why? Because it's a little less offensive. See, God hates sodomy still today. He judged the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah for the sin of sodomy. Sodomy is listed as an abomination. An abomination is a sin that God wholly detests. See, we have changed murdering babies into a name called abortion. Why? Because it doesn't sound as bad if we abort babies, but murdering babies, that sounds horrific. Let me say, sin needs to be called out. Abortion is nothing less than murder. See, we justify our sin by making it a normal way of life. And I'm telling you, it's filtering in through our schools. You know what they're doing? They're getting in our public schools today, what they're doing is they're getting us used to, getting our kids used to this transgender movement, this homosexual lifestyle, premarital sex. I'm just making sure I didn't see any little ones in here. That's what the schools are trying to do today. You know they're teaching about this stuff in elementary. It is wickedness. And folks, we are slipping further and further and further away from God. The majority of teenagers have been taught intolerance so much that it's just a way of life and it's accepted to them. They don't even realize it's bad. See, we need to stop allowing the liberals and the children to run in our country, and we need to step up and take that rightful role. Stand up for Jesus. Deuteronomy 13:1, again, it says, if there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, I don't care if it's a school teacher, I don't care if it's a president, I don't care if it's a representative, I don't care if it's your parents. Hey, listen to me. If it's against what God has to say, it's wrong. It says, ye shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice. The average child sees nothing wrong with sin of disobedience, disrespect, and dishonesty. Can I tell you, when I was growing up, which wasn't too long ago, and Brother Ed, I'd hate to see what it was like whenever you were a kid. But I tell you what, if I was dishonest, if I was disobedient to my parents, if I was disrespectful to another adult, it wasn't unheard of for that adult to slap you across the face. Anybody else grow up like that? Or was I the only abused one in this? I mean, you just didn't disrespect an adult. But listen, what do we do today? Our kids are being raised. It's okay. If they say something wrong, it's okay. Stand up for yourself. Stand up for yourself. No, be respectful to what the Bible says. Say about it. Obey them that have the rule over you. This is good Bible preaching. God says that salvation is in trust only. Trust only. Some try to say that there are many roads to get to heaven. What they're doing is saying that they know better than what God knows. See, Jesus said unto them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus says, I am the way. He's the only way. He says, I am the truth. He's the only truth. He says, I am the life. Without him, we are dead in trespasses of sin. He is the only life. Jesus said, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. He said, there is no other way to come to the Father. Again, he is the only one way. Some try to say that everyone will be saved in the end anyways, won't they? Because God is a God of love. And God would never send anyone to hell. The Bible says, Revelation 20:15, and whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Not everyone, let me say this, not everyone is going to go to heaven. Wide is the gate and narrow is the way. The Bible says, but the fearful and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars. Anybody in here ever told a lie? You know what we deserve? We deserve to spend eternity in hell. But I'm thankful this morning that I'm not going there. See, who are these people? It is everyone who has never been saved. If you're not saved this morning, I'm not saying it mean-spirited. I am not, because what I want more than anything is I want to see souls saved. But if you die without the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, you will die and spend eternity in hell. I guess why this is coming, so this past week my mom's friend passed away. And he told me many times, you know, I talked to him many times about getting saved, and he said, well, I'm a Catholic. And I said, well, I don't care what you are. You're a sinner, and you need to be saved. And I talked to him many times about that, and he never got saved. And can I tell you this morning, I'm saying this with a heavy heart, that I believe that he died and went to hell. He's spending eternity, he's living in hell right now. See, salvation is part of the gospel presentation. It is still the blood sacrifice with the death of the Lord Jesus Christ that still purchases men and women from the slave market of sin. It's still the blood sacrifice with the death of the Lord Jesus Christ that puts away the sin curse. Death should not bring fear to the born-again believer. Folks, I was talking to someone the other day, I think it was Brother Travis. Heaven's not what scares me. I'm looking forward to going to heaven. I tell you, I think the Lord allows people to, after they get saved, allows people to love their families and stuff like that. Why? Because if they didn't, they'd just want to go to heaven right then and there. Just kill me now, Lord. I want to go to heaven. But I said this, Brother Travis, the only thing that's holding me here is my family. I want to see my family. I love my family. And I'll get into that in the next message. But I'll say this, that we don't truly understand what heaven's going to be like. If we did, I think all of us would probably be longing to go right now. See, it's still the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead that finalized our salvation. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Some think that if they're good enough, they'll get to heaven. Well, there's none good, no, not one. I was telling Brother John this morning. He says, how you doing? He says, I'm pretty good. And I said, well, you ain't pretty and you're not good. You guys ought to know that. Don't ever tell me that you're pretty good, because none of you is pretty and none of you is good, all right? There's only one pretty one, and that's my wife, and she's not good, so I can tell you that much. So I do think she's pretty, but I can't say she's good. She's not in here, is she? Oh, she's hiding behind. She's hiding behind Brother Caleb back here. I didn't see her. Anyways. Some think as long as their good outweighs their bad. You ever heard that? Yeah, God has a big giant scales in heaven. And as long as our good outweighs our bad, then we're going to heaven. No. But we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousness as our filthy rags. For by grace are you saved through faith. Why do some think they know? They set the standards. They're the ones. They're the exception to the rule. I'm going to go to heaven because I'm better than so-and-so, or I've done more good than so-and-so. Then I want you to see this. I'm going to get in. I won't get into all of it today. But anyways, number three, God says the scriptures are the truth. You know, there are many people that are trying to say that these are not the real writings, but can I tell you, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. The Bible says all scripture is given by inspiration. That word inspiration means God's breath, the breath of God. This is the very breath of God that we hold in our hands. Do you believe that this morning? Well, some say it's just fairy tales and fables, and some say that it's just another book. The Bible says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. The Bible says, but the word of the Lord endureth forever, and this is a word which by the gospel is preached unto you. The Bible says in Psalm 138:2, I will worship toward the holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth, for thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. This is the preserved word of God. The perfect preserved word of God. Do you believe that this morning? I don't care what people say. I don't care if the government says that, hey, they've ruled that it's illegal. Because you know, realize in some countries, it's illegal to have the word of God. Why do you think that is? That's Satan. That's the world. That is people not wanting people to know the truth. Then let's get into the last thing, and I'll finish here. But God says that the sanctuary is terrific. David said this, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Folks, let's get excited about going to God's house once again. I mean, I love God's house. I love God's people. I mean, believe it or not, I actually like coming and seeing you folks. What's hard for me to imagine is that you still keep coming back. God says that this sanctuary is terrific. Not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as men or some as, but exhorting one another so much the more as you see the day approaching. The world wants to say that the church is a waste of time and money. All that pastor wants is to get your money. Anybody ever told you that? Can I tell you, I don't get your money. You give it to God. In return, God gives me some back. But can I tell you this? Even if I'm doing what God wants me to do, even if I wasn't getting paid, it wouldn't matter. It doesn't matter. If you feel like I'm here to take your money, keep your money. Keep it. Don't give it. You say, preacher, you're telling me not to give my money? Yeah, listen to me. Don't listen to what God says. Listen to me. See, there's a lot of people out there that want to tell you things, but what does God say? That's what matters. Your friends are going to lead you astray. I'm just telling you, your unsaved friends are going to lead you astray. God's word will never lead you astray. God will never lead you astray. In conclusion, it's time to choose to obey God rather than man. Deuteronomy, let me read this one more time and we'll close. If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and giveth thee a sign or a wonder, and the sign or the wonder come to pass, whereof he spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods which thou hast not known, and let us serve them, thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet or the dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God proveth you to know whether ye love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Ye shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and ye shall serve him and cleave unto him. It doesn't matter what I say, what you say, or anybody else say. What does God say? That's what matters. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. See, the choice is yours. Do you want to listen to people? Or do you want to listen to the Savior? Do you want to listen to what the world has? Or do you want to listen to what the Word says? The choice is still yours. There's many people that make that choice not to listen to the Word of God. It's the wrong choice, but they still have the opportunity to choose. You can choose right or you can choose wrong. The choice is up to you this morning. Again, I'm not trying to be mean or ugly. I just want to put it out there. We know the truth. We've heard the truth this morning. What are you going to do with it? Maybe you hear this morning, you say, Pastor, I know 100% sure that one thing that I know that I know that I know, I know that I'm saved. Pastor, I just want to, as a testimony, I just want to thank the Lord this morning for saving me. Would you raise your hand? Thank you, Lord, for saving me. You know that for sure, yes. Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I couldn't raise my hand. I've got some questions. I've got some doubts. I just don't know for sure if I was to die today. I just don't know for sure. Pastor, pray for me. No one else is looking around. I just want to pray for you. Pastor, pray for me. I just don't know for sure that I'm saved. Please pray for me. Would you raise your hand? Anyone like that? Pastor, pray for me. All right, maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I'm saved, but I haven't been living for God like I should. I haven't been standing up for God like I should. What I mean by standing up, I'm not saying being mean and ugly and going out and holding up signs and just yelling at people and being hateful. I'm not talking about, I'm saying you take a stand. People know where you stand on things. Maybe you hear then you say, Pastor, I haven't been standing up for Christ. I haven't been doing what I should. I haven't been living for Christ like I should. Pastor, pray for me. I need to draw nigh to Him. I need to get closer walk with Him. Pastor, please pray for me. Anyone like that? I see hands, yes. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank You for Your love. Thank You for the message You put on my heart, for speaking to my heart about this first. And Lord, I pray that we will take this message, not as one that is mean-spirited, but one that is with a heart of love and a heart that wants to be a blessing and help to folks. Lord, I pray that, Lord, You apply this message to our lives. Help us to draw nigh to You. Lord, there have been some that raise their hand saying there's some areas in their life that's just not right or whatever the case. Lord, I pray that You would draw them closer to You. Lord, for that one that's near as hell, Lord, I pray that You'd save them before it's eternally too late. Do a great work, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Would you stand to your feet? As Miss Haley begins to play here, God spoke to your heart. Maybe you just want to come and do business with the Lord. Maybe you just want to thank Him for your salvation. I don't know how He spoke to you this morning, but if He spoke to you, the Bible teaches us to harden not our hearts. Thank you. You may be seated. Let me have the men come forward. We'll take up this morning's tithes and offerings. As they're coming up here, just a few announcements. I want to say happy anniversary. I put birthday because I copied and pasted, but happy anniversary, Brother Greg and Miss Suzanne. And yes, half a century. He married her when she was 3 years old, believe it or not. It was legal back then, I guess. I don't know, but happy anniversary, Brother Greg and Miss Suzanne. We love them, don't we? Appreciate their faithfulness, and so pray for them. And then, of course, our missionary of the week, Brother Keith Davidson. I'm sure I'll have him come in soon and give an update, but Seedline purchased a van to carry scriptures and to do different things, and so they were blessed by this. A church donated $20,000 towards it. They just need $6,000 more to pay for the plates and just different things, setup fees and just different things such as that. And so we're going to be praying about what we can do to help them to get the rest of that money in as well. But pray for Keith Davis and Seedline. Pray for Brother Danny Lovejoy, our Deacon of the Week, our Family of the Week, Brother Roy and Miss Kathy Buchanan, and then our Trustee of the Week, Brother Phil Bousman. Remember these folks in your prayers. Don't forget, next Sunday is Time Change Sunday, okay? And so mark that on your calendar. Our teen service on March the 24th. April the 6th is our prayer breakfast. April the 12th and 13th is our couples retreat. If you're interested in going, today's the last day to sign up. So we need to know for sure if you're able to go. Please sign up, because next week we have to put the money in. So you say, well, I haven't turned in the money. That's okay. Just get that to the church as soon as you can, and we'll take care of that. And then April the 19th, mark your calendars for this. We're going to have a Good Friday service. Last year we had it here, and Brother Wes preached, and then Brother Bert, his church done the music. And so this year we're going to have it at Brother Burt's church. I'm preaching, and Brother Wes's church is going to be doing the music. And then the next year we're going to have it at Brother Wes's church. We'll provide the music, and then Brother Burt is going to preach. So it's a wonderful thing. Invite some folks to come out to it. We want to pack the house out. We really want to just invite folks to come. What a good time to come to a Good Friday service, okay? That is April the 19th. Make sure you mark your calendars for that. Brother Jimmy, sir, please ask a blessing.
Father God, thank you once again for the Sabbath that we can gather in our world to meet with our church friends, to hear from you, Lord. We just thank you for the message that we've heard today, Lord. And ask the Lord that you lead and guide and direct us, for we love you and desire to be pleasing to you, Father.
Yes.
Lord, we ask your blessing upon this, which we're about to give back, a small portion of what's all that you've blessed us with, Lord.
Yes.
We pray you magnify for your glory and honor. We love you, Lord, and thank you for all these good things. In the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
This morning we're going to have our afternoon service in about we'll take just a couple minute break, and but we're going to close in a word of prayer. And those that need to leave, we want to dismiss you and appreciate you being here this morning. Let's all stand. We'll close in a word of prayer, and I'm going to ask Brother Kirk, would you mind close us in a word of prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you again for another precious and blessed day to be in your house and to have fellowship, Lord. And to see your love you have for us, Lord. We pray that you continue to bless those who didn't make it and those who need you. Who need your healing hands spiritually as well as physically, Lord. And we pray that you light and guide our paths, Lord, through your week, and to help us, Lord, shine your light, to have you shine your light through us, Lord, and be a blessing to your will, Lord. And we pray that you continue to keep peace in Israel, Lord, and watch over our nation and our president. Be with us all, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.